Okay, so that's good. So we understand what is a necessary condition and what is a sufficient condition for something to be vector. Let's try to understand how we can do math with them, because that's something we'll need to do, okay? But before we do the math with them, that is the algebraic formulation, let's look at the graphical representation, right? So we look at the alternate representation of the vectors. We look at the alternate quadrant frame representation, which is very, very important, because this is one thing that I find students struggle with quite a bit. So pay attention when I get to this. Managing direction determination is just a matter of definition, how we add and subtract vectors, and how we multiply vectors, right? So those are the things that we want to look at. So graphical representation. Now, if you have a vector which has direction and magnitude, graphically representing it is not difficult. All you have to do is show it as an arrow. Okay, so if I want to draw, let's say, 55 miles per hour vector, which is pointing along northeast direction, right, so that's 45 degrees from the east, all I have to do is pick a scale, right? If I want to really draw it, let's say using a ruler and a pencil, I can say, hey, I'm going to pick maybe 10 miles per hour as 1 centimeter. Then all I have to do is draw 5.5 centimeter long line, put an arrowhead over here, and draw it at 45 degrees from east, right? And my job will be done. So if you had a graph paper or a piece of paper, you could easily do that. You pick your scale and you draw it, right? So the magnitude part is easy to do. Direction is something you can do with a projector, or maybe you can use even a CAD tool to do this, right? Okay, so that's fine. So graphical representation is not a problem. But it is very hard to do any kind of algebraic operation with graphical representation of vectors. If I said that, hey, I want you to multiply this with a scalar factor 2 and then add maybe, another vector to it and subtract another vector to it, you could do all that using graphical operations, but it gets tedious after a while, because you don't want to really draw, right? I mean, we use math as a tool. We want to use math as a tool to make our life simpler, and that's what we want to do. So graphical representation is nice to look at, but doing math with it is very hard, right? Okay, another property of the vectors is that the vectors that we deal with in this class are called free vectors, okay? And why are they called free vectors? They're called free vectors because you can take a vector and move it anywhere in the space you want. As long as you don't change its direction and you don't change its length, which is the magnitude, you are not changing anything about that vector, right? So if I have this represented as a vector, I can move it anywhere I want in the space, as long as the orientation doesn't change and the length of this doesn't change. It is still the same vector. Why? Because vector is defined by the length, the magnitude, and the direction. If you're not changing either of them, then the vector is not changing. Where the vector is situated, is located in the space, is not important. Now you might say, hey, that doesn't make any sense, because if I take, let's say, an object and apply a force on it, I could push on it, I could pull on it, I could apply the force at different places with the same magnitude, same direction, but the effect would be different. And that's perfectly right. The effect on the object would be different. But as far as the representation of that vector force is concerned, it's the same representation. Nothing is changing about that, right? So don't confuse that with the actual outcome on the physical objects in the real world, okay? Vectors we deal with are free vectors. If I take this and I move it around, as long as it's always pointing at 45 degrees from east or north, and the length is not changing, it's the same vector. So moving it in the plane, moving it in the space is not a problem. And that's why they're called free vectors. Yes?
So is there any kind of other vector, like you can move it wherever you want?
You can move free vectors anywhere you want.
So free vector you can move, but like, right. I'm asking, is there any other vectors?
Yes, there are quantities that if you move them around, they will change the essential property. But the vectors we are dealing with in this class are basically free vectors, right? So forces, moments, they're all free vectors, right? Okay, so let's talk about algebraic representation. Now, there are two kinds of algebraic representation that we deal with. One is polar representation. Now, what's a polar representation? Well, the idea with the polar representation is really very simple. So we know that a vector can be specified by both direction and magnitude, right? Magnitude part is easy. It's the direction part that we have to think about a little bit. How do we really specify the direction of something in terms of a number? Right? Magnitude part, we already have a number. How do we specify direction? Right? That's the main question. So if, let's say, I wanted to show this vector, I want to write this vector, velocity vector, in an algebraic way, I could definitely write the magnitude, which is 55, Now for the direction, well, this is the direction, right? So how do I really pick a direction along that arrow? What I would do is I would pick what we call a unit vector. What's a unit vector? Unit vector is a vector that has unit magnitude, right? So I will pick a unit vector along this direction. Why a unit vector? Because, you know, it's the simplest possible vector I could pick. I could pick, you know, twice the length of unit vector, but it's pretty arbitrary. So just to specify the direction, if I can write a unit vector along this direction, which specifies the direction, then I can write the whole vector as the magnitude times the unit vector. So now this is encoding the information about this, about the length or the magnitude, and E hat, which is a unit vector along this direction, is telling you what direction it is. But it doesn't seem very satisfying, right? Because what is E hat? How do we really write E hat? 55 is fine, that's the magnitude. How do we really write E hat, right? So this is what we call a polar representation. It's a very compact way of algebraically representing a vector. But I'm pretty sure that you have seen something else as well, right? So let's talk about that. And that's called Cartesian representation.